what's your gang's names?
Ben.
C-Dot.
I saw those girls.
Yeah, I saw them in the program. You were the halftime show.
Double Dave, Derek, also.
Sweet. So you guys are some of that Klingsman? You've never seen anybody with so many friends to where they can have this big group. It's pretty awesome. Well, you're brightly colored, I gotta say that.
Thank you.
that you are here with me on this special day. I have no doubt that you'd be proud of both Matthew and I. I know you're watching from the holes in the floor of heaven, and I know you know I love you with all my heart. I love you, Dad.
Laughs, you know, and it's fun to be able to sit here in front of them And as we go through some of these things, I'm sure we'll laugh about some things because some of the memories will come back to mind. But you know, man, Sloan, you guys are going to hear a lot of advice when you get married. In the hours, in the days, in the months, in the years to come, you're going to hear a lot of advice. Some of it's going to be great. Some of it's going to be subpar. And some of it will be just downright terrible. Okay? All of you who are married could probably attest to that. That's probably just the truth of it. But what I want to let you guys know is that the Word of God will always stand true. And that this will be your ticket for success. If you guys want to have a successful marriage, if you want to have the greatest marriage, God is the one that holds that plan for you. And so I want to go through this word real quick. From Ephesians 5, 22 through 33. And I want to read over that section and then just break it down just a little bit for you guys. But it says this, "Wives, be subject to your own husbands, as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he may sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but he nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church. Because we are members of his body, for this cause a man shall leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each individual among you also love his own wife, even as himself. And let the wife see to it that she respect her husband." And you guys, it was such a powerful, word. There was three things that really stood out to me. In that section that you just heard, the word Jesus Christ, he is referenced 13 times in those 12 verses. 13 times in those 12 verses. And I think what Christ is trying to say is, in order for you to have a successful marriage, I have to be in the center of that marriage. I can't just be a spoke on a wheel. I can't just be part of what my marriage is about. I can't just have a career as part of it, and home life as part of it, my family as part of it, church on Sunday as part of it. I think what Christ is saying is, I have to be the center. Now, a lot of marriages have great marriages, but they don't have Christ in the center, and you will never have the marriage that you could have if Christ was in the center. And I think Jesus is making that obviously clear. The second thing that stuck out to me is in that verse, in that section, three verses, it talked to the wife. Specifically to the wife. Specifically to you, Shalom. Eight verses, it spoke specifically to men. Eight. And one is spoke to both of them. So, what I'm saying here today is that Matt, as the leader, as the head of this marriage, you have a lot more responsibility. Now, both of you have 100%. Both of you have 100%. I won't tell which one this came up in premarital counseling. But, but both are responsible. Yeah, Matt, we won't say it. We won't call it. But both of you are 100% responsible for what God calls you to. But Matt, as a leader, God is going to be the one. He's going to hold you responsible. And I think in those verses, it makes that abundantly clear. So Shalom, I'm going to go back to you. And in that verse, it talked about the wife submitting to the husband as you would Christ. And I think the word submission has a bad connotation today. I think it gets the wrong impression. And what Christ is saying, Shalom, as you submit unto Christ, that's the way God wants you to submit to man. As you would give everything to Christ, because you know the way Christ loves you, and you know the trust that you have for Christ, the same thing is for man. And if you willingly place yourself under Christ as the lead in your marriage, if you will do the same thing for man, God will do amazing things in your marriage. And it's nothing about being a doormat. It's nothing about being less valuable. It's all about fulfilling the role that God has for me. Shalom in verse 23, it says that God is the head and the savior of the body. That word savior means deliverer, healer, the safe place. And as Christ is that in your marriage, Christ ultimately is that for you, but God compared him to the savior in your marriage. He is to be the deliverer. He is to be the healer, the safe place. He is going to protect you. And so when you submit under that to him, God will do a mighty work in your guys' marriage. God will do awesome things. And that's what that word submit means. To willingly place yourself under. And let Matt take the board. Matt's role is to protect you. Matt, God sets the standard high in that marriage. He says, God calls you to love shalom like Christ loved the church. All of you, to love somebody like Christ loved the church, that is a standard that is so high that you can't look to your next door neighbor, you can't look to your best friend Joe, you can't look to your pastor or your role model to be that standard. That standard is Jesus Christ. And Matt, when you look at your relationship, and I know you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, Christ, when you think about what he did for you, and you think about how he rescued you from sin, and he pulled you up from that place, and he forgave you, and he pursued you, and all those things that go with it, and he died for you, that is what he calls you to do for Shalom. And when you can do that for her, that's the kind of love that God's talking about. And you guys, that's a mighty love that God has called us to live for. The man to love his wife like Christ loves the church. That's an awesome standard to have. Matt, your love has to be unconditional. And what that means is, no matter how Shalom treats you, no matter what goes on, and I guarantee you there's going to be times when you're like, oh, I'm going to be put to the test. Man, that love has got to be unconditional because Christ's love was unconditional. It doesn't matter how Shalom treats you, you're still 100% to love her like Christ loves you. That love has got to be sacrificial. And what that means is that love is going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something. And it's going to be divinely true. There is no way that Shalom can submit to Matt and Matt can love Shalom the way they need to unless it is divinely driven, supernatural. But as Christians, that's what we have. That's what we have living inside of us. And so that's the standard that Christ sets for each of us. And Matt and Shalom, that's what he's called you to. You know, there was one verse in there that was huge, and it said that the husband will nourish and cherish the wife. And what I thought about was in the very beginning, when Christ created Adam and Eve, Adam was to work the garden. And Matt, what he's called you to is to nourish and cherish shalom. And what that means is you have to provide the soil for her to be able to grow. And to cherish basically means that you remember who she is. Both of you, when you go back and you watch this tape, and when you get into God's Word, and when you look into each other's eyes, and when you remember what God's done, what he's going to do, cherish who he's made you. God has fashioned each of you uniquely like nobody else here. Like nobody else out there. He brought you two together, and cherish that moment. Live it, and remember who it is that God's created the other to be, because you're going to be unique, you're going to be different. You know, this kind of goes to everybody sitting out here. In that verse, it called them to leave their family and to cleave to each other. And what that basically means is that glue that once used to hold your family so close together, you've got to get a new glue. And that's you guys. That has to be tighter than any other glue that's out there. Because if it's not, it will start to pull you apart. And this is your responsibility. Those of you who came to watch, that know Shalom, that know Matt, that have given into their lives and they've given into your lives. If Matt and Shalom should ever come to you with something about each other, it is your responsibility to drive them back to each other. Okay? That's your responsibility as witnesses, as friends, as family here. You are to make sure that they cleave to each other and that you hold that precious for them. That's your responsibility. So you guys, so we kind of talked about Paul in Ephesians, and we talked about this whole blueprint of marriage. But the point is, where did marriage come from? Where did it all start from? How did these roles that Paul talked about, how did it become developed? You know, we can look at that and say, wow, that looks good, but where did it all come from? You guys, I want to read a section to you real quickly, and then we're going to chat for a couple minutes. But it says, the Lord God formed man of the dirt from the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. And then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And then he took one of his ribs, and he closed up the flesh of that place. And the Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man, and brought her to the man. And the man said, this is now bone of my bones, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. For this cause a man shall leave his father and mother, and they shall cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and not ashamed. Guys, man was created from the dirt from the ground. Man is very basic in nature, okay? We were developed from non-living matter, okay? So if we're a switchboard, a guy has an on-off switch, all right? Not too difficult to figure out, all right? We're not that complex, all right? Sorry to break it to you. Anybody that didn't know that, I'm breaking it to you. We're not that complex. But on the other hand, God saw that, he saw man in his completeness, and he said it's not good for man to be alone. And so what he did was he took out a man, took out of this completeness, pulled out this woman, and created woman from the man. And basically now you have two people that are incomplete. And the woman was taken from living matter. The woman was taken from the man. And the woman is a lot more of a complex being. If you were to see a switchboard like I just talked about, a woman is going to have many different knobs and lights and switches and volume and a lot of different things that have to go kind of on just right for the woman to come alive. All right? That's just the way God created it. Men, we're made out of dirt. What do you have to do to keep dirt alive? Nothing. Okay? Nothing. Women, on the other hand, there's a lot of nourishment and a lot of cherishing that goes into that to keep that woman alive. But God basically said, I'm going to create this because I have now two that are incomplete without the other. And I'm going to bring you two together. And guys, the thing that's most on my heart is this. I believe that God created you two to be able to bring him more glory together than you could apart. And so he's going to take strengths and weaknesses in each of you, and he's going to bring that together. You guys are going to be challenged, but you're going to see so much of each other in that, and God is going to use those strengths and weaknesses to do things that you guys could never imagine to be done for his glory. And that's what we're here for tonight. For you guys to be here and give glory. Okay? So I'm going to give you guys a challenge. I like points, so I'm going to give them a 3-point challenge. My challenge to you is, will you trust Christ in the creative plan that he's given to you tonight? Will you trust him to do what he's going to do with you and submit to the roles that God has given each of you? That's my challenge to you. The first thing is this, you guys. You got to understand this. Love is a choice. It's not about feelings. Your feelings are going to go like this every single day. Some of us guys are a little more constant, but feelings go up and down. They change with the flavor of the day. My thing to you is to understand that God made a choice to love you, and to pursue you, and to forgive you, and to inside of you. And you guys have to make that same choice every single day. No matter what it takes, that you guys are going to make it work for his glory. The second thing I'm going to tell you is that marriage many times reveals who you really are. I didn't realize how selfish I was until I got married. You're going to see a lot of selfishness, a lot of pride, and a lot of unforgiveness. A lot of tendencies for unforgiveness to come out when you get married. And I guarantee if you allow those things to work out in your life, it will not only destroy yourself, but it will destroy what God has brought together. You're going to have to work hard at the whole thing about the selfishness and especially the forgiveness. To deal with that right away. And to go back to what God has given to you guys. And to remember who he is. And the third thing I'm going to tell you guys, and the thing I want to close with tonight, is this. And this is a huge thing. When you go out into the world, and God says, I call you to be the light of the world. I call you to be the light of the world. That people may see you guys and want to live in a relationship with Jesus Christ. This is the biggest thing I want you guys to understand tonight. When you go out into the world, you become a very picture of Jesus Christ. Your marriage is a picture of his relationship with himself. And if we are to go out and say we serve a living God that is greater than anything you've ever done, and yet they look at your marriage and they see that you guys, something, it could take something to break you guys apart, that something is possible, then how great is that God that you serve? What I'm saying to you is people will watch the way you live with each other. They will see the way you love each other. They will see the tough times you go through, but they will be encouraged by how you get through it. And when people see that, they'll see a very picture of Jesus Christ just by the way you guys live. And so my challenge to you is, this is an adventure, and it's fun, and it's awesome. And there are going to be things that are going to define you. Your true, who you really are is going to come out, but God is going to use that to define you and shape you into who you're going to be. So I'm excited to watch what God's going to do, and I'm excited to see you too. I know you guys are both competitive. So, strive for the standard that God has for you guys. Okay? You guys want to go ahead and stand forward. if you then, Matt and Shalom, have freely and deliberately chosen each other in marriage, and know of no such cause why you should not be so united, would you please join hands? Matt, in taking this woman that you hold by the hand as your lawful and wedded wife, before God and the witnesses present, do you promise to love her, to honor and cherish her in this life, and leaving all others, cleave only to her, and be to her in all things a true and faithful husband, as long as you both shall live? If so, please repeat after me. I, Matt, take you, Shalom, to be my wedded wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poor, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death do us part, according to God's word. Matt, do you promise to do this? If so, answer, I do. Shalom, in taking this man that you hold by the hand, as your lawful and wedded husband, before God and the witnesses present, do you promise to respect him, to honor and cherish him in this life, and leaving all others, cleave only to him, and to be to him in all things a true and faithful wife, as long as you both shall live? If so, please repeat after me. I, Shalom, take you, Matt, to be my wedded husband, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poor, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death do us part, according to God's will. Shalom, do you promise to do this? So answer. Now you are given to the other, for richer, for poor, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, till death shall part you. Matt, do you have do you have something to give to Shalom as a token? As a ceaseless reminder of this hour and the vow you have taken, please place this ring, the symbol of your love, on the hand of your bride, and repeat after me. With this ring, I promise you my love and all my worldly goods. With Christ at the center of our marriage, there is nothing that will ever divide us. Shalom, what do you give to Matt as a token of your love? As a ceaseless reminder of this hour and the vow you have taken, please place this ring, the symbol of your love, on the hand of your groom, and repeat after me. With this ring, I promise you my love and all my worldly goods. With Christ at the center of our marriage, there is nothing that will ever divide. Thank you. this candle here, it symbolizes unity. And the two shall become one flesh. This union is seen physically, emotionally, but most importantly, spiritually. As you begin your new life together, Shalom and Matt, with the desire to put Christ as the center of your marriage, may this desire not be hidden by the pressures of this world. As you, Matt and Shalom, light this candle, remember that you are no longer two persons, but one in Christ. Go into the world united.
Put
for this evening, Lord. We thank you for this special night. God, I thank you for Matt. I thank you for the godly man that he is and the godly man that you are. Shaping him to be. God, I pray that he will always, always seek you first, God. And that he would allow you to be the complete, in complete control of his life. God, that when he walks with you, it will be easy for Shalom to submit to him because she knows you're the will of God. And Lord, I pray for Shalom. Lord, I just thank you so much for, Lord, just all the years of memories. It's awesome. And God, there's so many memories left. And God, you are doing great things in her life too. And I'm just so thankful and just so happy to see her so happy. And knowing that this is God's will for her in finding men. Lord, just thank you for what you've done in their life. And I pray that they will be a great role model to others in the community and other kids in the community, Lord, that they will see a marriage that is built on you. And God, I pray that you will bring them many years of joy and happiness, Lord, but that you will use them in great ways for your kingdom. God, thank you for this amazing night. Lord, I know that they will always remember this night that you brought them together. Lord, just thank you for this time. Thank you for all the family, for the friends that traveled all this way to be a part. Lord, thank you for the ways that they have had such a huge impact on Matt and Shalom's life. And Lord, I just thank you for all the ways that Matt and Shalom have touched us. God, the way that you've created them to be, that they have reached out and changed our lives in amazing ways. God, the way you work marriage, the way you bring together a man and a woman is awesome. Even Solomon, in all of his wisdom, said a man with his wife, that's one of the most wonderful things to be able to see. A man and a wife together in love. It's awesome. God, may we always remember that. Lord, thank you so much for this. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. For as much then, Matt and Shalom, you come together according to the teachings of the Bible and the laws of the state. I, as a minister of the gospel, declare that you are husband and wife. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Matt, and may I present to you Mr. and Mrs. Matt Love.
your camping gear.
So, walking out to Chris Brown.